just about to start one of the most popular parts of the day, which is the Q&A session. I'm just going to ask you very kindly to remind everybody once again that the panel can't answer personalized treatment plans. Those need to be taken back to your own clinician. I'd also like to say a huge thank you to this panel of clinicians we have here and for giving us your time today, and hand over to Claire Harrison, who is going to chair this session. Can I also remind everybody watching online, you can still submit your questions because they will be coming in live, and Dr. Butt will be watching as the questions come. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Nona. Thank you, everyone. Oh, I see another doctor at the back, Dr. John Lambert. Right. This is an interactive session. It's harder for people who are online, but we have got them submitting questions. In the room, please do feel free to put your hands up. I just want to introduce the whole panel, because you may think it's only people who are speaking who are here today, but actually, there's a whole community of clinicians who are here. So we have Dr. John Lambert from UCLH, Dr. Andrew Innes from the Hammersmith, Dr. Andrew MacGregor from Newcastle, Professor Ruben Messer from Texas, which is bigger than the whole of Europe. Dr. Rachel Wells, who comes from Liverpool Clatterbridge Cancer Centre, Professor McMullen, who you've already met, lovely Sama Alamam, who was working with us on ET, has done lots of work on triple-negative ET, so if you've got questions for her, there, triple-negative ET, who's just finished her doctorate thesis, Dr. Noman Butt, who's also from Clatterbridge, he's handling the questions online, Dr. Joanne Ewing in her Joseph Technicolor Dreamcoat coat, Dr. Mamtagard Garg from Leicester, Dr. Alessia Khan from Leeds, and Dr. Rebecca Fruin from Gloucester. Huge thanks to all of them, and Noman and I have the privilege of being able to ask them all your questions now. So, let us start with a question about medication while you in the room, if you've got a question, put your hand up. So this is a question which I might put to Rebecca, actually. So this is a question about grapefruit and whether it can increase the effect of medications.
I think it's really just checking with your clinician what medications you are on. Certainly, there is a potential for grapefruit to interact with some medications, and you should really get advice from your clinician with which medications you're on. It's fine for a lot of the older medications, but some of the newer ones, you do have to be careful, I'm afraid. And star fruit as well, which is what people often forget.
Pharmacist is always a really, really good source of information about that, plus also the package leaflets. That's great. Okay. No questions in the room yet. If you do have one, put your hands up. Okay, great. Right. Excellent. Starting at the front then.
Darling, I'm a UCH patient, and my love for the haematology team there knows no bounds. I should have asked this probably in clinic, and I hadn't thought about it till I'm looking at your stats, and I love a stat. I'm on hydroxycarbamide. And because I've got a bleeding disorder as well, I have tranexamic on hand. And I've had three procedures and an operation and a couple of bad falls. So I've had to take the tranexamic for 8 days to make sure the blood clots. Is there any stat that shows you a percentage of the danger of going from a bleeding disorder to one that then clots your blood? I mean, I don't mean you either bleed to death or you die from thrombosis, but I just wondered if there was any.
Dr. Lambert, I think that's a question to you. Yeah.
Yes, I'm sorry. I'm looking at him and I'm sorry.
Right. Oh, that's a tricky question. Thank you. So I don't think there are any stats, partly because it's so different for each person. Some people, part of their disorder, particularly people who've got essential thrombocythemia, in addition to having potentially an increased risk of blood clots, also can have an increased risk of bleeding. And that can just be related to platelet count. And sometimes as a platelet count comes down, both the risk of bleeding and the risk of clotting come down substantially. So I think the most important thing to try to control both those things is, you know, if you're sufficiently high risk to have treatment, as you mentioned, hydroxycarbamide, for instance, to bring your counts down and help with both those risks.
Sorry, I should have mentioned that I normally have aspirin, and if something happens, you know, I'm having an operation or anything, I have to stop the aspirin and go on to the tranexamic. Mm-hmm. I've often discussed with Andrew Wilson, it's a sort of versus.
Okay,
seeing your stats.
Yeah. I think this illustrates the need to have a discussion about these kind of things and your own medication with your clinician. Because I just want to say that sometimes we will say stop aspirin. Some patients we do give tranexamic acid, which we actually give to women with heavy periods who don't have an MPN to help blood clotting. But everybody's individual situation, as I think you probably would say, John, is really needs to be individually managed, because for some people stopping the medication is higher risk. Go on.
No, absolutely. So I think it is such the causes of bleeding or potential bleeding, different people are so different. It very much varies on your individual circumstance. So I can't talk about your case specifically, but I think in general terms, you know, having the appropriate treatment, which, you know, may be hydroxycarbamide, it may be other treatments to reduce those risks, are the best thing. And if you are having an operation, then clearly you need to, the most important thing is to let your clinician know in advance that you're having that operation done, so they can then give you advice about what to stop or what to carry on taking, because only really your individual consultant can tell you that.
Thank you. Thanks to UCA.
Another question in the room, yep.
Professor Mead explained that the JAK2 mutation could occur 20, 30, 40 years previously, even in utero. What does that mean for the design and interpretation of epidemiological studies? Because you could be looking at not what happened to a young person, it could be what happened in utero, and perhaps we need to be asking what the parents did, not necessarily what the patient did.
Yes. I'm so glad Adam's gone to go to a firework party with his children now. Gave you all this interesting information, then he ran off. But actually, the perfect person to answer that question is Mary Frances McMullen, who has been working very hard on summarising epidemiology and is doing a prospective study. So, Mary Frances, that one's yours.
Thank you. So, that's a very good question. That has just come out relatively recently. What we're doing in the epidemiology studies is we're actually now trying to recruit patients within 2 years of developing their disease, so that we will then be, when we do the epidemiology studies, we're trying to get a sort of purer sample of what happened previously. And obviously, that's what this suggests, you know, is there a mutation early on? But the point is that they don't necessarily go on to have, just because you have a JAK2 mutation, you don't necessarily go on to develop a myeloproliferative neoplasm. So the epidemiology studies are really relevant, because what you're looking at is the other factors, because you're trying to work out what gets those people to develop a myeloproliferative neoplasm. Of interest, with the MOSAIC study, we are very keen to get samples on everyone and bank them. And we already have, from the earlier studies, the biggest bank in the world of samples. And we have samples both from the patients and the controls. So we will go on and do genetic epidemiology studies with a control group. That's for the future when we get the funding for it.
Yeah, and these are studies not only for MPN. These are actually really important studies for people who have these mutations, and we don't know if they're going to or not. So there's a huge amount of research that's been going on into that internationally as well. But thank you, Mary Frances. While we're passing the microphone around in the room, and while Noman is finding some questions online, I have a question here for Alessia. So Alessia is involved in the Haematology Diagnostics Unit at Leeds. And the question for you, Alessia, is at what point should an ET patient have a bone marrow test and or their spleen examined?
Thank you for the question. So I think, well, definitely the spleen should be examined in the clinic at the initial diagnosis and really at every visit just to keep monitoring that. And I think for, was it the initial bone marrow? Or the initial bone marrow would be, I think, depending on age, should be done for patients less than 60 at the initial diagnosis to give a baseline, which I think is really helpful to get the confirmation of the driver mutation. So is it JAK2, CALR or MPL, which would have been measured in the peripheral blood, and also to get a baseline of how the marrow looks and the grade of reticulin, so the grade of the fibrosis at the beginning of the diagnosis. And then at every clinic visit, the consultant will be looking at the all the different factors related to the disease, like the hemoglobin, how is it, the white blood cell count, the LDH, the spleen size, and looking at all those measurements, and of course the platelet count. And if those things are changing, for example, the anemia is getting worse, or anemia is developing and that's becoming worse, and there's no other explanation for that, so the iron levels have been checked and those are fine. So that's all really important to exclude other causes of anemia. As things if things are changing, then I think it's important to repeat the bone marrow at that stage and repeat the reticulin stain, so there's a good idea of what's going on in the bone marrow.
Perfect. Thank you very much. Okay, fine. So we're just moving a microphone around at the back of the room at the moment. Where is the microphone right now? There. Just there. Go ahead.
Yeah, in myelofibrosis, intermediate stage, is there any point in taking RUX before the spleen is too big? It seems that it's always treated when the spleen's already big. Is there any point in being a bit more preventative?
Oh, Professor Mazer, I think that question's for you.
So it's a very good question. First, I think as you think about the JAK inhibitors and ruxolitinib, really think of them as a therapy for myelofibrosis, not a therapy just for the spleen. You know, so the reduction in the spleen is part of the benefit, but certainly the improvement in symptoms. And indeed, as we really look, you know, there is an impact really on the course of the disease that is favorable in terms of helping delay progression in the disease. And clearly we think individuals, some who have been on ruxolitinib, have lived much longer. As we've looked at some of the data from the early studies that Claire and I were involved with, there certainly is a strong suggestion that using it earlier might be better than waiting for the spleen to enlarge, you know, both in terms of the benefit in terms of the spleen, but more importantly, kind of the aggregate benefit for the patient. You know, so at the current time, the U.S. guidelines, we have ruxolitinib as a consideration for everyone beyond kind of asymptomatic low risk. People are asymptomatic low risk, otherwise feeling perfectly fine. We still think that that might be a okay situation to observe. But if someone is symptomatic low risk or beyond, we will at least certainly consider it. But weighing all the other individual factors in terms of whether someone should be on therapy.
Well, that's great. Thank you very much. So while the microphone's coming back, Dr. Mantagog, you have got a huge experience of using Pegasys in Leicester, and you've collated the UK's biggest experience. There's a question here which I think is perfect for you. Can Pegasys cause extreme anemia?
I haven't seen it. But can it cause it? If the only time that I've seen anemia coming on in pegylated interferon is when the disease is transforming already. So I've been too late to start it. So the patient of ET is becoming myelofibrotic, and interferon was started around the same time and the patient becomes anemic because of the disease rather than because of interferon. Does that answer?
Yes, and or because of, absolutely perfect, and or because of any reason why anybody else who doesn't have an MPN might have developed anemia. It's really important not to always assume it's due to. Thank you so much, that's perfect. And thank you for your work with the Pegasys data. Noman, you've a question from online.
Yes.
Mr. Andrew Innes.
So, Andrew, this is getting into science. So it's, can you explain what allele burden is to the audience and how might it change with progression of disease?
Yeah, so allele burden, I guess, when you're looking at JAK2, what you're doing is looking at the DNA in the blood tube that you've taken out of the person. So there will be all of the cells basically in the blood there. And you look to see what percentage of that DNA has got the V617F, or the V617F or normal V617. So basically you're looking at, I guess, at the DNA level, what percentage of cells have that mutation. And you remember, I guess, that your DNA comes from two copies of your chromosome. So normally you will have two V617s, and so it's sort of like 50% means that you have a mutation in one site. But the problem is that, you know, that becomes complicated because because JAK2 is quite a sort of complicated gene, I guess, and I'm probably going a bit too far, but basically it's the percentage of cells, roughly speaking, that have the mutation. And how does that change with disease is another question, I suppose, that we tend to see lower levels in ET than we do in PV and MF, but that's not absolute. And we're still sort of trying to understand what happens over time with treatments and whether treatments change the percentage of cells that have that mutation and whether that has any impact on what happens to the underlying disease. So I guess the summary is it's the percentage, the allele burden is like the percentage of DNA that has that, which is a marker basically of the percentage of cells that carry the variant mutation.
Well, that's
did I pass?
Yeah, absolutely. So Andrew's other role is in chronic myeloid leukemia, where monitoring mutations is, we know a lot more about it, and it's used very much to guide treatment. In the MPN field at the moment, it's not really used. We are tracking and learning about that. And the only time when we would really monitor allele burden, other than in a clinical trial or for research, is after stem cell transplantation at the present time. So one more question from online and then we'll come back into the room if that's okay. Noman.
Okay, so the question is, if your hematologist is not an MPN specialist or linked to an MPN specialty, do you think it's beneficial to seek a second opinion from a specialist on your diagnosis and treatment? I think Joel's going to take this.
Yeah. So, I mean, I think that's very interesting. And I think some patients will be being looked after by somebody who's perhaps looking after almost only MPN, and others with specialists who are hematologists, who are hematology consultants, that will be able to look after MPN along with perhaps many other different areas of hematology, but they will be capable of that. And what we do to support that, and I think pretty much everybody on this panel here is involved in this, and that is that we develop guidelines. So guidelines for specialists are like a set of guardrails, really, to determine what is the best first track and sometimes second track of treatment, and to sort of support them in that, so that there is a sort of standard of care that your hematologist, even if they're not only dealing with MPNs, would be able to follow and would help them to support you. And the other things that are available through, say, MPN Voice are a lot of information and written information sources and sources that they can direct you to that also sort of helps to ensure that education of patients right across the board really sort of is disseminated and can be sort of used by all hematologists that are treating you. What I would say is that there are perhaps certain time points, and certainly I do see patients who are referred from more general hematologists or you know, sometimes even from specialists who are on this panel who will perhaps be looking to see whether they are eligible for a clinical trial or if there's a particular time point in their disease where things are difficult. So, you know, multiple intolerances to treatment, or, you know, things are not quite fitting within those guardrails of the guidelines. And I think that's really the point at which some patients may benefit from that specialist advice. I don't think everybody needs that at the outset. I think it is important that you form a trust with your own local haematology service, and that it is that trust, and it is that getting that you know, sort of one-to-one with your haematologist locally. But certainly if things are not fitting in those guardrails, that's the point at which I would say it's a good idea to perhaps just seek another opinion, or see whether there's something else available.
And you will probably find your doctors already liaised with other doctors. We are all always emailing each other and asking each other questions. Let's take another question from the floor. There's one down here and then we'll go back up there.
Yep. So hi there, my name's Ginny. I've came here today with my mum. It's a bit of a mindfuel, all of this, because I'm finding out a lot of this information today. So excuse me if my next question is a little bit general, or, you know, if it's not
general questions
already.
Are good.
Okay.
We don't provide consults on the hoof, especially not in a public arena.
Fantastic, thanks.
So general is fine.
So, okay. So my next question, so I noticed on the people who get diagnosed are generally being 20 to 40 and then looking at 65 plus. So my question is, what happens to the people in between? And more specifically, my mum said when she got diagnosed, they put it down to the menopause and kind of tried to brush off some of the symptoms, i.e. the eye symptoms. Things weren't like joined together quick enough. So my question is, should women, men, you know, between those age groups, you know, try and get a blood test, or when they do get you're brought in for your routine test, do they test for these things, or should we actually specifically be asking for those tests?
Okay, Rachel, did you want to comment on that? Thank you very much. That's a great question, and yes, thanks for being here today with your mum.
I'll say thank you for your question, and then say sometimes it's very useful because it'll pick up other things. I think when you have, I think many of us can be very familiar with sort of having symptoms that we can't necessarily explain, and in across general medicine generally there will always be patients coming with symptoms that can't be explained, and a lot of, there'll be many stories around being passed off as being something else, or being anxious. I was myself passed off as being completely anxious about something, and it can be something else. It doesn't have to be, and I'm not just talking about myeloproliferative neoplasms, I'm talking about any particular medical disorder. So it comes back to basically, I guess, if you've got symptoms that you can't explain that are unusual to you, then you go and speak to a doctor. And I think it's a case of, and I know it's frustrating because you often have to keep going back, and there's lots of stories about people going back several times before they're diagnosed. But the nature of medicine is that it's not exact, and we've all got different sort of experiences. And whilst we all know how to take a history from a patient, you know, sometimes things can get missed. And so it's important that as a patient, you're almost your own advocate, and as well as working with the doctor. And I appreciate that seeing general practitioners at the moment isn't as easy as maybe it once was. But at the same time, if you've got symptoms that cannot be explained, then just basically go back. So going back to the question about that age group, we diagnose, you know, people with MPN, you know, obviously all ages. And yes, menopausal symptoms and things like that can confuse the situation, particularly in women. So again, you know, and, you know, Alice gave it a very, very clear example earlier of how she had, you know, migraineous symptoms and it was passed off. And again, it's just about, if you have got symptoms that are unusual and you're worried, then I'm afraid it's a case of just being persistent. Sorry, I don't know whether anybody else has got anything to add.
That's great. Thank you. I mean, the other thing is, don't forget, GPs often don't know about these conditions, but yes.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Yes, but I think, yeah, it's difficult, isn't it? But then I think that's where liaising with your local team, we can liaise back with the GP, as Rachel was suggesting, and often the clinical nurse specialist can be really helpful.
Yeah. I think a full blood count is such an easy, simple test to do. So it's usually would be picked up if you had a persistent symptom that wasn't explained. Most GPs would actually do straightforward full blood count and biochemistry. So I think it would then be picked up. So sorry, I should have actually answered that first. I beg your pardon. Yeah, no, I'm sorry.
Okay. Yeah. Perfect. Let's go. There's another question in the room there, and then I can see you had your hand up several times, so don't worry. Yes?
Hi. My question has to do with the causes of inflammation. I'm sort of aware of cytokines, but are there other substances, and where do they come from? Are they released from blood cells, or is there some other mechanism which causes them to be released into the system? Because if you suffer with aquagenic pruritus, then when the system's stimulated, you suddenly get this sort of rush of pain.
Yeah.
So it happens very quickly.
Yeah. I think that's actually a really, really, really tricky question. And I bet everybody on our medical panel is sitting here thinking, actually, I really don't want to answer that one. because actually, we don't really understand that properly. We understand a bit about the immune system, and Patrick talked about the immune system and COVID. But we don't really understand a lot about inflammation and how it drives cancer, or how it specifically drives symptoms. So I could turn to Ruben and ask him the question about inflammation and fatigue. And we do use different attempts to try to moderate that. I think the most important aspect of inflammation is, which is common to MPN patients and the population in general, is inflammation due to lifestyle. So smoking, weight gain, not taking exercise, etc. So I'm going to bundle your question up and ask, in addition, this to Andrew McGregor, if that's okay with you, Andrew. I can't see your face. So the question is about cardiovascular risk factors, because actually vascular risk, being overweight, inflammation, body fat, etc., it's very common. So your question plus, given that cardiovascular risk factors need to be carefully managed in patients with, it says ET, but we're going to have MPN. Do you recommend statins, and should a statin or similar management be brought in early? And are there any other recommendations? Andrew, are you comfortable with that?
Yeah. So I think inflammation is difficult, but certainly these inflammatory chemicals are produced by cells within the blood system. And it's not quite clear whether sometimes the cancer is driving the inflammation, or the inflammation sometimes drives cancer, or whether it's what started first. And I think we do see some MPN patients particularly do have a lot of these inflammatory type symptoms, like the sweats, like the itch, and some don't. And why that is isn't really quite clear. Ruxolitinib's got a good anti-inflammatory sort of component to it. And when we give people with these symptoms ruxolitinib, often those symptoms really, really are really helped. So that's one thing that we can do about it. The second part of the question is that what I do is I tell my patients to see their GP at least once a year for a full, what I call, cardiovascular risk assessment. And that might be seeing the practice nurse rather than the GP, but that includes getting their blood pressure checked, getting their cholesterol check, getting a diabetes check, getting the weight check, advice about losing weight if they need to, advice about stopping smoking. And then those risk factors can be modified. And if once all those risk factors are put into a calculator, including the cholesterol level, if it comes out that actually the risk of cardiovascular disease is on the high side, then the GPs will often start statins. I have to admit, I don't know what other people do, but I personally don't start statins, because GPs are far better placed to do that rather than me as a haematologist. You wouldn't want me monitoring your statin, I have to say. But I do recommend the patients visit the GP at least once a year for those checks.
That's great. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Like many older people, I have a complex number of conditions, and I have primary immunodeficiency as well as primary myelofibrosis, and I'm on watch and wait. It's been indicated to me that I shouldn't have ruxolitinib because that would not go with my primary immunodeficiency. And I just wondered whether any of the drugs coming, the JAK inhibitors coming down the line, are likely to be better for people with primary immunodeficiency as well as myelofibrosis.
Professor Mesa.
So none of you are just an MPN, of course. You're all individuals with your own medical histories, potentially other medical conditions, your own level of fitness and awareness and everything else. So clearly everything is always very individualized. And even statements such as, you know, balancing both of those conditions. And again, there's not a tremendous number that have both, you know, but I would not view as, you know, a reason that one could not use ruxolitinib at all. It would increase the risk. There are certain risks of infection with ruxolitinib, although they are in some relatively specific things. You know, I think if you were in a situation where they needed to consider one at the moment, you know, the JAK inhibitors are all a little different now that they inhibit the JAK2. That is something that they all share, but some inhibit the JAK1 more as well. These are a series of different proteins that act as both on-off switches for creation of blood cells, but also have various roles in the immune system. So most likely one might consider, again, something like fedratinib, which is available in the UK, that is a JAK2 inhibitor, but without the JAK1 inhibition properties of ruxolitinib, that probably would have a lower likelihood of some of the secondary infections, if one needed to do that today. But again, as things evolve, you know, there may be other therapies that come into play.
Thank you.
Great. Is there another question in the room? There's one at the back. Yeah.
Hi. I just was wondering, is there any evidence to suggest that certain medications can be used as a preventative measure in regards to progression, especially in younger patients?
Okie dokie. Rebecca, do you want to take that one? Or you can say no if you don't want to.
I think that's a very difficult question that other people may have things to put in, because I think there's very little evidence apart from taking the primary preventative actions of, you know, the healthy lifestyle, making sure that you do all you can to keep yourself fit and healthy. And then there is the role of aspirin for certain selected individuals as well. But unfortunately, that's at the moment, as far as I'm aware, where the evidence base is. I don't know if anybody else.
So the opinion from Gloucester is the same as the opinion from Guy's Hospital. It's probably the same as the opinion from UCH and maybe the same as the one from Texas and Newcastle and Hammersmith, etc. It's a difficult thing. So you need to look very much at the individual. That we are doing some trials of bringing treatments earlier. For ET patients aged between 40 and 60, we did a big randomized study in the UK asking, should we treat in addition to aspirin? And the answer was, it did not benefit in terms of transformation risk, but that treatment was hydroxycarbamide. So we're refining our thoughts on that all the time. I sense Ruben wants to give an opinion. Your body language says you do, yeah?
So it's a very important question. You know, as we've done global surveys, first in the US, but then here in Europe and the UK, of what patients want most. And clearly the answer was, we want things that can help to avoid progression. You know, so that's a very strong need. Now you sense a reluctance from the panel, in part because we still lack a couple key things in understanding the biology of the MPNs. Why do they progress? So a bit what we struggle with, and there's evidence that again, interferon may help certain people avoid progression. We don't fully understand all aspects of that. But I think what we seek scientifically is to understand, why does any one individual progress? Can we measure that? You know, can we, if we design a medicine, can we have any confidence that it's going to help to avoid progression, and can we monitor it? Do we increase the dose in someone to try to better avoid progression, or can we get by with a lower dose? So clearly we want to be able to develop medicines that can be more preventative. You know, I sit with new patients with MPNs, that if their disease never progressed from the moment that we first visited, it would likely never be a threat to them. It is progression which is the greatest threat. So there's a lot of, you know, very smart people in laboratories as we speak, doing a whole range of research into the biology of MPNs to try to answer that question. So I hope that we get to the point that yes, we will be able to use medicines in a preventative way, but hopefully in a way that they could be guided by science, as opposed to, I'm going to give this to you and just hope that you don't progress.
Thank you. That was a very eloquent answer. Yes?
Thank you. I wanted to ask whether, what are the markers for going for a transplant? Like for my husband, he progressed from PV to MF in 5 years. Now he's staying with the MF for the last 4 years. So at what point consultant will decide that he needs to have a transplant?
That's a really excellent question. So I'm going to ask Andrew Innes that question, but I'm also going to suggest that you watch the webinar on Wednesday, which will have Tuesday, sorry. It's a busy week this week. But Andrew will be there with Donal and two patients who've had a transplant, and there are patients in the room who've had transplants too. So Andrew.
Yeah, I think that was my thunder. It's a complicated thing that we will talk a lot more about, I guess, on the webinar on Tuesday. I think it's really difficult to decide where transplant fits in patients' pathways. And we have some information we can use, like the DIP scoring system, that gives us an overall prediction of, if we take 100 people, how many are likely to do better with transplant or not. But I guess the important things are that those apply to 100 people in a room. And actually, you are one person now, and you need to really understand all of the implications for what will happen if things go well, what might happen if things don't go well, what might happen if we don't do anything, if we're going to do it, when should we do it, how should we do it, what are the potential donors, who do we have that, you know, who would be what might sway our decision one way or another. And there's just lots of things that sort of get factored into the final decision that, you know, everybody needs to be sort of comfortable with, I guess, because transplants are not an easy process. And it's a long haul a lot of the time. So it's very individualized, but everyone, it takes a long time to really understand what are all the factors for each person. And it's really about lots of discussion about what is the right thing for you and when is it right for you.
I think the consultant says that we need to monitor the blast cell, but then if the blast cell goes quite high, doesn't that mean that we are going towards a leukemia? And we have that fear that we shouldn't be in a state where we can't do anything about it.
Yeah, I mean, I think there are lots of scoring systems that give us an idea about what risks, when it's perhaps a better idea to do it. And some of those systems take into account the blast number. Some of them take into account things like age, but the thing that you have to remember in those situations is that those will be scores that are derived where they take exactly the middle age. So one of them, for example, takes the age of 57, and it says if you're above 57, you get 1 point for additional risk. If you're below 57, you don't. But in reality, we know that the risk is not going to be the same if you're 20 or if you're 56, or if you're 57 or 58 and 75. So there are lots of factors that all have to be added in, and certainly blast count is one of those. But there's no single thing that says, this is the switch, we should flick now.
It'll depend on how good the donor is, et cetera.
Thank you. There's so many things. Yeah.
There's another question at the back of the room.
Hello. Jamie here had his diagnosis 6 weeks ago, so we're in the very early stages of learning and getting to know what we're dealing with.
Great that you've come today.
Well,
great that you've come today.
Yeah, the first thing I wanted to say was we are so goddamn lucky to find you so quickly. And it's been tremendously supportive and informative and all the rest of it. But as I say, Jamie was diagnosed with MF at 6 weeks ago, with suspected ET for years. Previous to that, but you know, very minimal symptoms. So we have a diagnosis, and I think what we're challenged with right now is understanding what the treatment path should be, what questions to ask, and how to navigate I suppose, the best path in respect of treatment and understanding what prognosis is, etc. So my question really focuses around how can the panel help us, help you, help us, if you know what I mean? So to what kind of things do we need to be asking our consultant in order to, for him to help us understand what the path ahead might look like? Specifically for Jamie, let's say, you know, but what types of questions should we be asking?
Actually, Mary Frances, you sort of covered this a bit in your presentation. So perhaps you could just, we've only got 10 minutes, so it could take half an hour. I need more coffee. I think just the salient points and then I think maybe that could, we could cover that in the MF breakout group as well in a bit more detail.
So I think this was sort of what I was trying to get at in my talk, that you have hit this point, now you've got the diagnosis, fine, and you've got to cover a lot of information, exactly the questions that you're asking. You know, what is the treatment, what's the likely outcome, what's the prognosis, what are the good things, the bad things, and that's almost your questions. You've asked your own questions, if you know what I mean. But the problem is that is actually getting and processing satisfactory answers, particularly first time you go through it. You know, this is suddenly you've got this diagnosis and you're learning what that is, and you don't even think to all the things that you want to know. So what I would encourage you to do, because you will have another visit, and the next visit is the follow-up, and really be prepared to ask the questions to get them to take you through all the information again. I would very much encourage you to write down your questions. You know, you can think of it now and then you go in and it's all gone. So, you know, what you're saying, write it down and go in with that, because the doctor will expect you, you know, we all do our best, but you can't expect people to take all this in on the first consultation. So you would very much expect them.
And sometimes our information comes piecemeal, right? So we want to do extra tests. They can sometimes take a month to come back, the complicated genetics tests.
May I ask a follow-up in respect of, if you've had a bone marrow biopsy and you've had the genetic testing and you've had a full suite of blood tests, how realistic is it to expect a prognosis or, you know, some sort of guidance in respect of, you know, when symptoms might get worse? Or I suppose what I'm trying to come to, frame the question, how realistic is it to get an indication of what might lay ahead, or is it impossible to tell?
So the issue about this is that there are all these scoring systems. There are a number of different ones, which tells you that they're none of them perfect. But there are, Dr. McLaren discussed them very carefully, and they take in all this information. But what that, so they can all give you a prognosis, but the problem is that you're only interested in what's going to happen to you. And all of this is giving a risk. I always say to people, you know, it's telling what will happen 100 people, that if you take 100 people, then 50 of them are likely to be alive and whatever, or whatever is going to happen. But nobody can actually tell you what's going to happen.
No, understood.
Because as a patient said to me once, we can't see into the future, and thank God for that, you know. So you want to know exactly what's going to happen to you. And nobody can do that. All you can get is give with these systems, which you can get, the likelihood of this happening within that time. And, you know, you either get a big number or a low number, and that's the difficulty. Yeah.
And actually, the other thing to say is there are multiple scoring systems. Ruben and I once had a big laugh, didn't we? We were at a conference and there was a whole session on 6 new myelofibrosis prognosis scoring systems. So sometimes we score use multiple of them to give you an idea of range, which can be helpful too.
Okay.
So we've got just a few minutes. We're going to take
one or two more from the floor, but while we're doing that, there's a question, John Lambert, which I think is a good one for you, because you've been collating UK experience on ruxolitinib and risk of skin cancer. And you gave a fantastic presentation yesterday on this drug and risks of cancer, but specifically skin cancer. So the question is, in a patient with a history of sun exposure, are patients warned about this? It's a factor to bear in mind when changing treatment. And could you just give us a kind of headline on risk, please?
So I think the first thing to say is it's still quite an evolving field. We don't yet know really what the risk is. We know that a number of drugs used in medicine can increase the risk of other conditions and other cancers. So I think focusing on ruxolitinib, which is one of the drugs we've got a bit more information on rather than, say, the other JAK inhibitors, is something which we can do. It doesn't necessarily mean that the risk is specific or particularly high in ruxolitinib. So I think one of the key things to say is that there is some trial evidence that being on ruxolitinib, particularly for longer periods of time, can increase the risk of certain skin cancers, particularly what we call non-melanoma skin cancers. The extent of that risk is difficult to say, but it's probably a little bit higher than people who aren't on ruxolitinib or haven't been on ruxolitinib for very long. But that isn't, not all the studies have shown that, that's just some of the studies. But I think it is important to understand that if you are either on ruxolitinib or potentially going to be starting on ruxolitinib, to know that that is a potential risk, particularly if you're someone who's had skin cancer in the past. And that's something you definitely need to flag up to your hematologist, because that might, you know, affect quite what they say to you, and they may then need to talk to your dermatologist, for instance, if you've got a dermatologist looking after that, to get a conversation to try to calculate the risk. So I think that's the most important thing, that if you're someone who has had a history of skin cancer before starting ruxolitinib, to make sure you discuss that with your consultant. The other question, I suppose, is that risk the same for other JAK inhibitors? And the bottom line is we don't know, because there's less experience. We've been using ruxolitinib for 10 years in the clinic, the other JAK inhibitors far less. So I think it's work in progress to really work out whether there is a similar risk for other JAK inhibitors. They work in a similar, but not exactly the same way. As Professor Mazur was saying, they inhibit some same JAK, so they inhibit JAK2, but not necessarily the other JAK molecules. So the risk may be a little bit different, but it's too early to say that's the case. So certainly I wouldn't say, you know, to switch to a different JAK inhibitor just because there's you're worried about the risk of skin cancer. I think it's something you'd have a conversation with the consultant with. And then if necessary, they have a conversation with the dermatologist if you've got this background of skin cancer.
That's great. And just to remind that actually hydroxycarbamide also associated with risk of skin cancer, not just ruxolitinib. Yeah, there's a question over here.
Could you explain what the best way of monitoring is once you've been diagnosed in MF if the bloods were not mild, not hugely out? Were not a good indicator of the disease. It was a bit of a surprise.
Yeah, I think, Alessi, you covered that in a little bit of detail. So just to I can maybe praise it. So it's about monitoring symptoms, blood counts. And then we also look at blasts, and there's some other variables we look at as well. There's a marker called LDH that we can use. But again, it can be quite specific to the patient. Spleen size is also important. So we would tend to, in our unit, examine the spleen at least once a year, sometimes twice a year. So it's all really quite individual to the patient.
Thank you.
Okay, great. Is there another question in the room? If not, there's at least two quick-fire questions. While the microphone's going to Adam, Sam, there's a question for you about, do clinical trials collate and report side effects systematically? Thank you, John.
Thank you. I guess the short answer is yes. And I think it's really important to, kind of one of the questions to ask your haematologist is there a clinical trial you can be part of? Whenever we see patients on trials, it's one of the things we ask about. We grade whether we think some of the side effects are related to the trial drug or not, and we document pretty much all side effects reported, and they really do help guide doses down the line. Sometimes, you know, trials can stop because of side effects. So I think yes is the answer. They do.
And we also
and sorry, just to say, when the trial stops, you know, if it closes and you carry on the drug, we're still collecting that data. So it's really rich and longitudinal data that's important.
And we also collect side effects of drugs after they've been approved. There's a system to do that in the UK.
Hi, it's Adam Spoon here. So my question really follows directly on from that. I mean, it seems to me that it's a really exciting time in terms of the science, but it also seems to me that we as patients, the one thing that we can really do is volunteer to be on trials and accept to be on trials if a consultant. And so one question is, to what extent do you agree with that view? And secondly, I suppose the other question is, what can we do to encourage more people, both, you know, in this room, but sort of globally, to get involved in trials? Because it seems to me that is the critical thing, is to test these drugs and ideas.
I think we'll give you a big round of applause for that. Thank you very much. And I'm going to pass that to Jo. So Jo works in Birmingham, and that Birmingham is a massive trial centre. She puts lots and lots of patients on clinical trials. I think she's a good patient person to answer that.
Yeah, so and it is absolutely critical, you know, that you, absolutely what you say, and for a whole host of reasons. It may be something small, a blood test that then goes through to Professor Mead's laboratory or through to Cambridge that then can be followed up and provides that information. But then you've also got the drug trials, so there's different types of drug trials. It can be very difficult. I mean, although these diseases are quite rare, actually what we can find is that finding a patient that can fit all of the criteria for a trial is even rarer. So you've got sort of like a gap that narrows, and we try to find patients who can benefit from trials, but it can be difficult. So at the moment I've got a trial open, but you need quite a good platelet count, and I'll have people referred and their platelet count isn't quite high enough, but we keep trying, we keep looking. And you know, we've got a specific individual who's sort of, you know, searching through and extending out right across the sort of region or nationally, going through to Maz and the team at MPN Voice to sort of advertise the trial. So I think it is difficult. Not everybody will fit the criteria for a trial, but I think if there is a trial and we can get you in, we really will do our utmost to do that. But as I say, some trials are not even trialing specific drugs, but they're looking at things like Mary Frances has discussed today, where in the Mosaic trial, it's like looking at, well, why do patients get this? And trying to find patients that we can get all of that information and data from. We want to data mine you.
Data is really important. There's a massive call to data information in the UK. So we've challenged out to the NHS and universities to join up data. So you will probably be being asked by your hospitals to opt out of data. I know there was a GP thing about being opting out of data, taking samples. Many of us have biobanks and we will ask for samples, etc. All of that's really, really critically important. And the COVID trials. Patient number 58 contributed. Oh, perfect. So good. I think we've probably done now. I think I asked questions of all my colleagues. I want to thank everybody. Thank you to those of you online who submitted questions. Thank you everybody for answering questions and everyone in the room. The next session is actually the breakout group session. So that's another opportunity to ask a question if we didn't get round to it today. So we're going to move you around the building. If you are in the ET group, which is the largest group, please stay in this room. If you are joining the PV group, please go to the lunch room, which has been rearranged to allow you to meet with colleagues who will be in that room. For those of you who are part of the friends and family group or the myelofibrosis group, please go back towards the registration desk, and Derry, Alex and Carly from the Hartley Taylor team will navigate you to either the friends and family or the myelofibrosis group. So thank you very much. And for those of you who are online, just to say you can join the Remo interactive tables and network. Thank you.
Thank you.